singularities of the Lax-Alenic evolution. So we gave the relation last time between differentiability and calibrated curve. If you have a viscosity solution of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, and if U is differentiable at some point Tx, and gamma is the curve, is a calibrated curve ending at Tx, then in fact, the partial derivative of U with respect to X at Tx is the partial derivative of L with respect to V at X gamma dot T. And also there is a relationship for the partial derivative of U with respect to T, which is just obtained by using the Hamilton-Jacobi equation into evolution form and plugging in the partial derivative of U with respect to X. The second thing is that U is differentiable at Tx if and only if, with T positive, sorry, if and only if there is a unique backward calibrating curve ending at Tx. And the last thing is that if you have a calibrated curve, then U is indeed differentiable at every S gamma S for all S strictly between A and T, okay, where AT is the interval on which gamma is defined. We also introduce the Aubry set, okay, for a solution of the evolution Hamilton-Jacobi equation. It is a set of points, Tx, for which we can prolong indefinitely a backward characteristic ending at Tx as a curve which is still all along a backward characteristic. We also recall the notion of homotopy and stated two theorems about the topology of singularity. If you have, a function with value into minus infinity plus infinity, such that defined on M, such that its Lax-Alenic evolution U hat is finite on some band 0t cross M where t is positive, some open band, then the set of singularity of U hat, okay, in this band is locally contractible. Okay, so the set of singularity is a set of points where U hat is not differentiable. And the last theorem, the second theorem on singularity that I wanted to mention, is that if U is the sum of a global Lipschitz function and a bounded function, then its Lax-Alenic evolution is finite everywhere. And moreover, the inclusion in the set of singularities of U hat into 0 plus infinity, 0 and plus infinity excluded time M minus the Aubry set of U hat is a homotopy equivalence. Okay, so I'm not going to prove that theorem in the general case, but I'm going to treat a toy model, which is a distance to a closed subset, and as we will see, there is enough in it to understand how the proof goes for the general case. Okay, so we discuss the following thing. We consider the simplest Tonelli-Lagrangian on the complete manifold, complete connected Riemannian manifold MG that we introduced earlier. This Lagrangian is nothing but one half of the norm of V square. L0 of XV is one half of norm of V square. If you have a curve, its action, okay, as we said several times, is one half of the integral from A to B of the norm of the speed squared. And I'm going to show the fact that for this Lagrangian, the minimal action is just the distance from X to Y squared divided by 2t, which I already said several times. And in fact, if you have a curve with gamma 0 equal x and gamma t equal y, then we can use the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality to write that the length of g squared, which is the integral from 0 to t of the norm of the speed squared, is less by Cauchy-Schwarz, okay, than the integral of the norm of the speed squared plus the integral of 1 squared, which gives me t, and the first one gives me not the action, but twice the action, because the action is 1/2 of the integral of the norm of the speed squared, okay? So I can combine that with the fact that the distance between the endpoints of gamma is less than its length to obtain that the distance to xy square is less than the length square, is less than, by Cauchy-Schwarz, the integral of the norm of the speed squared times the integral of 1, and this is 2 times the action of gamma. Now, we know that we have equality in all the inequality above if and only if gamma of 0 t is a geodesic, okay? So to get the equality in the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, okay, you need to have the speed, the norm of the speed constant, okay? And so you get that it will be a geodesic parametrized by arc length, by proportionally to arc length, whose length is the distance from x to y, the distance between its endpoint. Hence, ht of xy is the distance of xy squared divided by 2t. Okay. And what are the minimizers? So for the minimizers, okay, we should, by the inequality here, because this is achieved, the minimizer are the minimizing geodesics. These are geodesics whose length between any 2 points is the distance in M between the points. Okay, so I'm using here minimizing in M and not in the universal cover as it would be in Riemannian geometry. Okay. So minimizing geodesic mean a mini geodesic whose length between any 2 points is the distance in M between the points. So this follows from here because the minimal action is precisely the distance from xy squared divided by 2t. Now, if C is a non-empty subset of M, as we already said, we define the function dc of x as is usual by the infimum for C in C of the distance from C to x, where d is the Riemannian distance. Now, note that the distance to C is the same as the distance to its closure, C bar in M. Therefore, in the sequel, we will only assume that C is closed. Okay, we always assume C closed. Now, in this case, C is exactly the set of points x in M such that the distance from x to C is 0. As we already did, we introduce the modified characteristic function psi sub C from M into value 0 plus infinity, which is 0 on C and plus infinity outside. And because C is non-empty, psi C is not identically plus infinity, okay? And because it's also non-negative, we know that its Lax-Olejnic evolution is finite everywhere. And in fact, from the equality we already mentioned, this Lax-Olejnic evolution for T positive, okay, at Tx is distance from C, from x to C squared divided by 2t. So what are the singularities of psi hat C? Okay, well, they are because of the formula here. There is not the partial derivative with respect to t always exists, and the problem is, of course, partial derivative with respect to x, so the numerator. So, in fact, the singularities of psi bar c are of the form 0 plus infinity times the singularity of the function d square c. So singularity d square c is a set of point x where the d square c is not differentiable. Note that d square c is differentiable everywhere on c, which is a set of points where d square c vanishes. In fact, on c, it vanishes up to second order, therefore the derivative is zero. Okay. And therefore, the singularity of d square c is the same as the singularity of dc away from c, which I denoted by singularity star of dc. Now, if we apply the general theorem to the Lax-Olejnic evolution psi hat c, we conclude that the singularity of psi hat c is locally contractible. This singularity is a product 0 plus infinity times singularity of dc. And in fact, this implies when you have a product like that, which is locally contractible, in fact, each one of the factors is locally contractible. For 0 plus infinity, this is obvious. But so we obtain the result also for singularity of dc, singularity star of dc, which is also the singularity of dc square. So if c is a closed subset of the complete Riemannian manifold, then the set of singularity of dc square or the set of singularity of dc away from c is locally contractible. So in fact, this theorem for a general closed subset is quite strong. In fact, what do we know about DC? We know that it's a Lipschitz function. So the set of singularity is the singularity set of a Lipschitz function. But the only restriction we know, I'm not claiming it, that it's the only one, but for Lipschitz function, but at least what we know for Lipschitz function is that the set of singularity should have measure zero, and there is very little more that we know. In fact, that's probably the only general thing we know. But the general such set is definitely not locally connected, okay? If you think about it, for example, a set of measure zero could be a Cantor set, which is definitely not locally connected. And if it's locally contractible, it's locally connected. So So if you are a little bit more sophisticated, you might object to this argument. In fact, it is known, and we will see it for the Euclidean metric on RK, on the Euclidean space, that locally in a chart, the function dc square is the sum of a c infinite and the concave function. Therefore, we should rather expect the singularity of dc square to be the singularities of a general concave function. Okay. For a general concave function, for example, from phi from R to R, to look exactly at what happens here, let's look at the case of a general concave function from R into R. The singularities of phi are the jump of the derivative. Okay. The derivative is any non-increasing function. The jumps are countable, okay, usually, but they are also dense in R in the general case. If you take a non-increasing function, you can have jumps, dense jumps, okay, of the derivative. But a locally connected countable subset of R has only isolated point and cannot be dense in R. Okay, so the set of singularities of DC is very, very special among the set of singularities of general Lipschitz function. In some sense, it looks like an infinite codimension subset. Okay. And in fact, there is no a priori reason from what we knew before that the set of singularity should be locally connected. Okay. So what we knew basically, if you have a viscosity solution of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation for a Tonelli Hamiltonian, this viscosity solution is locally semi-concave, and therefore the singularity should be the singularities of a, look like a singularities of a concave function, but clearly from what we mentioned here, we are very, very far away from that, from the general case. So let's look at the backward characteristic for the function psi hat c. So a curve is a backward characteristic ending at tx if and only if gamma t equal x, the action is the minimal action possible between gamma zero and x, so a d square of xy divided by 2t, and d square c d at x divided by 2t, which is of course the Laxalainic evolution of psi c at tx, should be equal by definition of backward characteristic to psi hat c at zero gamma zero plus the action of the part. Okay, now because for t positive, psi hat c is always finite, that tells me that necessarily I must have psi hat c of zero gamma zero finite, which means that gamma zero is in c, okay, because psi hat c of zero gamma zero is just by definition of the Laxalainic semi-group psi c at gamma zero, and this has only two possible values, zero plus infinity, and the value zero is taken only on c. So the inequality above, now because of the definition of, because we showed what is the minimal action in this case, becomes the distance from x to c squared divided by 2t is equal to the distance squared for gamma zero to gamma x. And this is of course equivalent to distance of c of x to c is the distance from gamma zero to x. It is usual to call projection of c the set of points c in c whose distance to x is precisely the distance from x to the closed set C. Okay, so this is called the set of projection of x on gamma. In other words, the projection are the point of x where the point in C where the inf in the definition of the distance from x to C is attained. So it is easy to show that the set of projection is never empty. And therefore a calibrating curve ending at Tx is a minimizing geodesic, sorry, a backward characteristic. It's more than calibrating because it starts at zero. Okay, is a minimizing geodesic between a point gamma zero in C and X whose length is the distance from X to C. Okay, or equivalently, it is a minimizing geodesic with gamma zero in the projection of X to C and gamma T equal X. So the differentiability theorem implies the distance function is differentiable at x, not in C, if and only if there is a unique projection of x on C. Okay? Here, and also, there is a unique minimizing geodesic between x and the unique point in the projection. For a general M, because you may have conjugate points, okay, so you need to ask not only that the projection is unique, but there is a unique geodesic, minimizing geodesic between the point and its projection. And the second thing is that if you have a minimizing geodesic with gamma B not in C and gamma A in the projection of gamma B, then DC is differentiable at every gamma S with S between A and B. Now, when there is a unique projection, sorry, it's something I don't control, the noise. If there is a unique projection of X on C, it is convenient to denote by C sub X, the unique point in C, which is a projection of X on C. I will use this notation. Now, what is the Aubry set for Xi hat C? So, the Aubry set is the set of graphs of gamma, the part of the graph, okay, T gamma T with T positive, where the union is taken over the curve such that gamma restricted to zero S is a backward characteristic for every S positive. Note that gamma S is a backward characteristic for every S positive if and only if gamma is a minimizing geodesic with gamma of zero is in C and the distance square of gamma S to C divided by 2S is the distance square of gamma zero to gamma S divided by 2S, or equivalently, distance of gamma S to C is the distance of gamma S to gamma zero for every S positive. Okay, I'm going to call this the dagger equation. Now, this last statement implies by continuity letting T go to zero, because the right-hand side will go to zero, implies that in fact automatically gamma zero is in C. Okay? So if this is verified for every S and gamma is a minimizing geodesic, okay, then in fact this gamma is going to be a backward, is going to be a, one of the gamma that defines the Aubry set. So the Aubry set of Xi C is the union of the part of the graph of gamma for T positive, where the union is taken over the minimizing geodesic that satisfies the equation dagger, which is the distance of gamma S to C is the distance of gamma zero to gamma S for every S positive. And of course, or it's equivalent for every S non-negative. Okay. Now suppose that gamma is such a minimizing geodesic, what we can do is for S positive, we can define the curve gamma sub ST is gamma ST. So this curve is also a minimizing geodesic. If you reparametrize by changing the time by a constant of a geodesic, it's a geodesic. And if it's minimizing, it remains minimizing. And obviously, if it satisfies dagger, the gamma S will, if gamma satisfies dagger, gamma S will also satisfy the same equation. Okay? Hence, the union of all over all S positive of the graph of the gamma S is included in the Aubry set, okay? Because each one of the gamma S is also one of the geodesics that give you part of the Aubry set. Now, if you look at what is the union of this graph of gamma S, it's T, gamma TS with TS positive. Okay, so this is always contained, as we saw, in the Aubry set of Xi hat C. But if you look at this set of T gamma TS, T and T arbitrary non-negative and S positive, T and S positive, you just obtain that it's zero infinity times the image of gamma, okay? The image of the interval zero plus infinity, open in zero and plus infinity of gamma, okay? Therefore, you can say, if you set AC is the union over curves gamma of the image by gamma of the interval zero plus infinity, so this is a subset of M, and the union is taken over the minimizing geodesics for which Dagger is satisfied. So if you call this set AC by the inclusion here, in fact, you know that the Aubry set of Xi hat Xi is zero plus infinity times AC. So in fact, we are going to call AC, which is a subset of M, the Aubry set of C. Now, every constant geodesic with value in a point in C is minimizing, as is every constant geodesic. And of course, it satisfies Dagger, because the two sides of the equation are zero. Okay, so the constant geodesics are part of the family you consider, and therefore, you have C is always contained in the Aubry set of C. And if we define A star C as the complement of the Aubry set of C in the Aubry set of C, we are going to get this part by taking the non-constant geodesics, which satisfy the constant geodesics that satisfy Dagger and takes value in C give you the part C. So we obtain that A star C is the union of the gamma of zero plus infinity, where the union is taken over the non-constant minimizing geodesic such that Dagger is satisfied. Okay, so you have the part C and the part A star C in the Aubry set. The part A star C is obtained by taking the non-constant minimizing geodesics for which Dagger is satisfied. Now, note that for a non-constant geodesic, the norm of its speed, which is constant, like for every geodesic, it's not zero. And therefore, because if it is minimizing, the distance from gamma zero to gamma s is the integral from zero to s of the norm of the speed, which is a constant v, so it's vs. And when s goes to infinity, this goes to plus infinity. So this implies that A star C does not intersect any bounded, by bounded I mean a relatively compact connected component of M minus C, because also D, the distance is complete, the Riemannian distance, this is the same thing as saying a bounded connected component of M minus C is a connected component which is bounded for the Riemannian distance. So A star C does not intersect any bounded connected component of M minus C. Okay, we obtain now, this implies that the bounded components of M of the complement of the Aubry set of C in M are the same as the bounded component of M minus C. In particular, if M is compact, A star C is empty, and AC is equal to C. So the global homotopy theorem for psi hat C implies that the inclusion of the singularity of psi hat C, which is 0 plus infinity times the singularity of D square C, which is also 0 times infinity times the singularity star of DC, the inclusion into the complement of 0 plus infinity times M of the Aubry set of psi hat C, which by the structure of A of psi hat C is the same as 0 plus infinity times M minus the Aubry set of C is a homotopy equivalence. Okay? Now, 0 plus infinity is contractible, and therefore we get that the inclusion of the singularity of D square C, which is also the singularity of DC away from C, the inclusion in M minus the Aubry set is a homotopy equivalence. Since M is compact, as we observe that AC is equal to C, and in this case, in fact, theorem 6 was obtained by Albano, Canarsa, Nguyen, and Sinistrari, already in the case when M is compact, the global homotopy theorem for closed subset. Okay, let me also connect this with cut locus in Riemannian manifolds. If Mg is a Riemannian manifold, the cut locus cut x of x in M is defined using the exponential map, but you have also, in fact, that cat x, we know, I mean, can be shown that the cat locus of x is the closure of the set of singularity of the distance to x, okay, away from x, different from x. So as we saw, the set of singularity is a set of Y in M that can be joined by two distinct minimizing geodesics to X. I'll close the window, excuse me. Okay, so the set of singularity for dx is just the set of y that can be joined by two distinct minimizing geodesic to x, and the cut locus is the closure of that set, as is well known. And the part which I denoted by conj sub x, which is the cat locus minus the singularities of dx, singularity star of dx, is part of the set of point y conjugate to x in the sense of Riemannian geometry. So this has been generalized to the cat locus of a C-Du submanifold for which you can use Jacobi field. By this, I mean you can define what is the closure of cat x, and you can relate it to points conjugate to the C-Du submanifold. So as Marcel Berger said in his monograph on Riemannian geometry, the difficulty for all this study is an unavoidable dichotomy for cut points, the mixture of points with two different segments and conjugate points. So the methods that we are using permits to separate the study of these two sets for the first time. And so they bring new results in the subject. So now let me restrict even more and look at the Euclidean case. So our goal now is to give the proof of the global homotopy theorem for a closed subset in Euclidean space, where of course I am using the Euclidean Riemannian metric on X, okay, which is just given by the Euclidean norm. So the theorem becomes, suppose you have a closed subset in C, then the singularity of D square C, the inclusion of the singularity of D square C in the complement of the Aubry set of C, the homotopy equivalence. Note that I said that the Aubry set is closed, and of course this implies the Aubry set of a Lax-Solenic evolution is closed, and this implies also that AC is closed, as you can check from its definition. Okay. And because RK minus the Aubry set, which is a closed set now, RK minus AC is an open set, it's locally path connected as an open set of RK. So the theorem above is equivalent to, for every connected component, U of RK minus AC, the inclusion of the set of singularity contained in U into U is a homotopy equivalence. Okay, because a homotopy equivalence of the complement of RK minus AC will have to map every connected component in itself. And if you have a homotopy equivalence for every connected component, because they are open, you can just put them together or obtain a global homotopy equivalence. Now, the case you bounded was obtained by Lyotier. This case was obtained by Lyotier in 2004 for a bounded component of the complement of a closed set. Okay. Of a closed set. It was obtained by Lyotier. And for unbounded components of the singular set of the distance function, it was obtained by Canarsa and Perron. I'm not sure of the date, no? Pier Marco, this is not the correct date, yes?
I'll check, tell you.
Yeah, because it's after Lyotier. It must be 2010.
Yeah. Let me check.
Yeah, it could be 2010,
yes.
Yeah, guess. I did a misprint here. It's a misprint, it's 2010. Okay. So note that in the case of Euclidean space, the minimizing geodesic between X and Y are the segments parametrized, are the segments from X to Y parametrized with a constant speed.
No, actually it's 2001.
So is Lyotier is 2004?
I think so, yes.
Okay.
June 1st.
Okay, sorry. Yeah, it probably doesn't contain exactly the same statement about the homotopy equivalence.
No. It's yes, right. It's just classification of the components.
So my statement here is correct. Yeah. It's not correct.
Yeah, it's not exactly the same result as Lyotier.
Okay, just I should say the case unbounded was studied by. Okay. it would be more correct to say that you started the study of the unbounded components. But you showed that they are unbounded. That was a...
Yeah.
Yeah, that the singular set was unbounded, if I remember.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, that's what you... Okay. Okay. Well, anyway, the minimizing geodesics between two point x and y in Euclidean space, there is only one up to a parametrization by constant p, it's the segment xy. Now, of course, in that case, because there is only one geodesic between two points, the differentiability for dc at the point x, not in c, so dc is differentiable at x, not in c, if and only if the projection of the set of projection of x onto c has only one element. And also if x is not in c and cx is any point, is any projection of x, the function dc is differentiable on the open segment between cx and x. And in that case, the projection of any point in between cx and x is exactly cx, okay, because you are differentiable at y. So what is the Aubry set? It is the union of c and all the half lines starting at a point c in c and such that, so geodesic parametrized by 0 plus infinity, okay, are just half lines or constant points, okay? So it's a half line, AC is this union of C, and all the half lines starting at a point C in C, and such that the distance from X to C is the norm of X minus C, or the distance from X to C, for all x in the half line. And let me also mention that here, the local homotopy theorem applies to give that for every closed subset C included in RK, the set of singularity D square C, of the singularity of D square C, which is also the set of singularity of DC away from C, is locally contractible. So this statement was not contained in any one of the previous works that we mentioned, the local statement, it's new. So let me do some example in R2 to give you some feeling about what is going on here. So I put the X and Y axis in green, maybe. Okay, the singularities in red. Well, mainly the important thing is the singularities are in red and the Aubry set is in blue. Sorry for people who cannot see the colors, but... So let me start with a simple set, the set reduced to zero in R2. So in this fact, it's differentiable on R2, D square. So it's differentiable, the square of the distance to zero is differentiable everywhere, okay? Not only on R2 minus zero. And the set of singularities, of course, empty, okay? And this is clearly closed and locally contractible. Okay, so what is the Aubry set? The Aubry set is in fact R2 because, okay, and the set of singularity is included, which is the empty set, is included in the R2 minus the set the Aubry set, which is also R2. So R2 minus R2 is empty, and this is indeed a homotopy equivalence. Okay. Now, if we take two points in R2, so what are the set of singularity, the set of points from which we have two geodesic, two segments joining the point to C2 with the same length, two distinct ones, and therefore it's exactly the y-axis, and it's also closed and locally contractible. Moreover, what is the Aubry set? Well, in fact, it's a complement of the strip minus 1, 1 times R. Okay. And of course, the y-axis, which is a set of singularity, is contained in that strip, which is a complement of the Aubry set. And it's a homotopy equivalence. In fact, they are both contractible. In both examples, the closure of the set of singularity is also locally contractible. Now, let me go to the case of the linear Cantor set. So suppose K1 is a linear Cantor set, and we denote by I sub I the bounded component of the complement of the Cantor set in the x-axis. Okay? What are the singularities? So it's a set of points for which you can find two points in the Cantor set, which give you the distance to the Cantor set. And it's not difficult to see that this is a union of the mediatrices of the segment II. It is indeed locally contractible. And what is the closure of that set of singularity? Well, it will contain not only the singularity, but also all the vertical lines d sub c from a point c in k1. And this one is not locally contractible. In fact, it's not even locally connected. Here it's not locally contractible, it's not even locally connected. Okay? Because you have countable lines that accumulate on another line, countable disjoint lines that accumulate on another line. Now, what is the Aubry set? The Aubry set is the complement of the union of the strips I sub I times R. Okay? So you look at the strip for each connected, bounded connected component of R times 0 minus K1. Okay? So you have a strip of vertical line above that bounded connected component. And the union of all this is the complement of the Aubry set. So the dashed bands are in fact half planes. Okay, so they are bounded, it's half plane bounded by the leftest most vertical line through the Cantor set and the rightest vertical line through the Cantor set. Now, if we look at the inclusion of the set of singularity into the complement of the Aubry set, which is the union of the band, it's also a homotopy equivalence. In fact, the connected components of the complement of the Aubry set are just the II times R. Okay, each one of these is a connected component. And they are contractible. And if you look at the part of the singular set which is contained in II cross R, it's exactly the mediatrix DI of II. okay, which is also, which is a line and is of course contractible. Now in this case, so in the previous case that I showed you, we had only one connected component. You can of course put several finite points and you will get several connected components, but this is a case where you have in fact infinitely many components in the complement of the Aubry set. Now let's look at a circular contour set. So put a contour set on the unit circle and denote by gamma I, so the unit circle is S1, denote by gamma I the connected component of the complement of the contour set. Okay, K2. Now the set of singularity is the union of the rays, the half lines from zero, delta I, that cuts gamma I in its middle point. So you look at lines starting at zero and you look at the union of the ones cutting delta I in its middle point, and this union is a set of singularity. Again, the closure of the singularity is not only this line, this delta I, but also the union of all the line. It contains also the union of all half lines from a point zero, from the point zero to a point C in the Cantor set. And again, the closure is not locally contractible. Now, to describe the Aubry set of K2 for each C in K2, denote by LC half, the half line contained in the line joining zero and C, and that start at C. Okay. And does not contain zero, so it's a blue line here. And the Aubry set is the union of these blue lines that I draw here. And the inclusion of the singularity in the complement of the Aubry set is indeed a homotopy equivalence. In fact, the set of singularity and the complement of the Aubry set are both contractible. In fact, they are star-shaped with respect to zero. Okay, so for any point in one of these sets, the segment between the point and zero is contained in the set. And this is enough to make it contractible. Okay, so in the first three examples, the set of singularities is a submanifold, okay? So for example, let's see for the third, it's just a bunch discrete of discrete countable lines, disjoint countable lines, so it, okay, which has no accumulation point on any one of the lines, so it's indeed a submanifold. But in this case, it's not a submanifold because the point zero here is obviously a point at which it's not a submanifold. So this is not the case in the last one. In the first two examples, the closure of the set of singularity is also locally contractible. But this is not the case in the last two ones. Note also that in the last two cases, if the linear measure, in the Cantor case, if the linear measure, or more precisely, the one-dimensional Hausdorff measure, of the Cantor set is positive, then the two-dimensional measure of the closure of the set of singularity is also positive. So there is a very nice example by Mantegazza and Minucci of a C11 closed convex curve in the plane, such that the closure of the set of singularity is not locally connected and has a Lebesgue measure, positive Lebesgue measure in the plane. When C is a C2 submanifold, so the example I mentioned is about a C11 submanifold. So it means that a C1 submanifold, in this case a C1 curve, and the tangent curve is Lipschitz dependent on the point. So when C is a C2 manifold, it is well known that the closure of the set of singularity of the distance to C is disjoint from C. So this uses Jacobi fields. Moreover, every bounded connected component of A n minus C can be retracted by deformation on the intersection of the closure of the set of singularity with that component. So it follows that the closure of the set of singularity is locally contractible. Okay. However, if the set of singularity is closed from when C is a C2 submanifold, for example, if you take a sphere and look at the distance to one point, round sphere, so what is the set of singularity? It's just the antipodal point. So it's indeed locally contractible, but it's also the closure. The set of singularity is also its own closure. But if the set of singularity is not closed, okay, even when C is a C2 submanifold, the local contractibility result is new for the set of singularity. Because as we said from the code from Berger, most of the method cannot distinguish between the set of singularity and its closure. Okay, maybe I should stop here. It's a good time to stop. And then I will do the proof of the global homotopy theorem for a closed subset in Euclidean space. Okay, so let's stop for 10 minutes.
Okay, thank you.
Professor time.
Okay.
Should we start?
Yes, okay.
Okay, so let me go to the proof of the global homotopy theorem in this particular case. So the proof we give is essentially obtained by streamlining the proof of the general case to this case. Things are more concrete, and this allows us to simplify the proofs. So let's start with the derivative of the distance function. Let's compute the derivative of the distance function in this case. So the square of the derivative, the square of the distance to C is differentiable if and only if at x, if and only if the set of projection is 1. And as we said, if the set of projection has only one element, we will denote by C sub x the unique projection of x on C. So if the function is differentiable at x in Rk, then the gradient of the square, of the square of the distance is given by at x, the gradient of dc square at x is twice x minus cx. Okay, so it's a vector x minus cx multiplied by 2. And if the function is differentiable, the distance function itself is differentiable at an x which is not in C, then the gradient of the distance function to C at x is given by x minus cx divided by its norm. Of course, the gradient should have norm 1 because the function dc has Lipschitz constant 1 everywhere. Now, to prove that, let's look at the distance of x plus v to c squared. So it's less than the distance of x plus v to the point cx, because cx is in c, distance squared, of course. So if I develop this, I get x minus cx squared plus 2 times the scalar product x minus cx with v plus norm of v squared. So the first term is the distance from x to c squared, plus 2 times x minus cx, the scalar product of x minus cx with v plus norm of v squared. So if in this last inequality that we obtained, which is d square c at x plus v minus d square c at x, is less than twice the scalar product of x minus cx v plus norm of v square, we substitute tv for v, where t is positive. So we obtain the inequality distance squared to c of at x plus tv minus distance squared to c at x is less than 2 times tx minus cx scalar product with v plus t2 square v. So if we divide by t this last inequality and let t go to 0, we obtain that the gradient, so if we divide by t and let t go to 0, the left hand side becomes the gradient of the distance squared to c at x, scalar product with v, is less than the limit at the right, which is of course 2x, the scalar product of x minus c with v for all v in Rk. Because this is true for all v, we obtain that the gradient of dc squared at x is 2 times x minus cx as we wanted. Now, if we compute the gradient of the square of the distance at a point where the distance is differentiable, we get that it's 2 times dcx, the gradient of dc at x. But if we are not in C, then dcx is different from zero, okay? It's x minus cx. And therefore, we obtain by using the result of the gradient of the distance square and the equality just below it, we obtain that the gradient of the distance to C at x is x minus cx divided by norm of x minus cx. Now, the next proposition is that the function distance square to C minus the distance to zero squared is concave. So this is x maps to distance square to C evaluated at x minus norm of x squared is concave. And therefore, distance square to C is the sum of a concave function and a C infinite function. So this is what is called the locally semi-concave function. Or a semi-concave function in that case. Okay, how do you obtain that? Let's look at the map fix y, and let's look at the map x minus y square minus norm of x square. If you just develop x minus y square, okay, you end up that this is equal to minus twice the scalar product of y with x plus y square. So the difference between these two functions is affine. So because the distance from square from x to c minus norm of x square is the infimum over all c in c of x minus c square minus c norm of x minus c squared minus norm of x c squared, which is an affine function. It's an infimum of affine function, which is finite, and therefore it is concave. Okay. Now, of course, the distance square is the distance square minus the norm square of x plus the norm square of x, but the norm square of x is a C infinite function, so that gives us the second part of the proposition. So here is the main tool. We can find the homotopy defined on Rk and for time between 0 and plus infinity with value in Rk such that it starts at the identity. So f of y 0 is y for every y in Rk. The second thing is that for c in c and s positive, f of cs is c. So f is the identity homotopy on C. Moreover, the distance to C of f of yx is larger than the distance of C to y for all ys in Rk times 0 plus infinity. In fact, this is also true for 0, but okay. So that means that, in fact, if you start away from C, you remain away from C. Moreover, the last one is the most important part. If the distance square to C is differentiable at the point f of ys for some s positive, then y is in, so because it's differentiable at f of ys, the projection of f of ys is unique, and as usual, it's called C of f of yx, and then y is in the segment from C of f yx to f of ys. From C of FYS to F of YS. And moreover, the function Y is differentiable. The function DC is differentiable at Y, okay? In fact, because it's Y is in the segment here. And you also can measure by how much the distance to f of ys has increased. So the distance to c of f of ys is 1 plus s, the distance of y to c. Now, this implies clearly that if you start at the singularity, if you start at the singularity, you can never enter the set of points where the square of the distance is differentiable, so you remain for all time in the singularity. Because of, if you, at some point you are not differentiable, then you are differentiable, d square c is differentiable at some fys, then it's differentiable at y. So if it's not differentiable of y, you never leave the set of singularity. Okay, so to do this, we are going to define a function phi indexed by ys. So suppose y is in Rk and s is positive. Now we define the function phi ys at x as the distance square of x to c minus 1 plus s divided by s of x minus 1 square. So this function phi ys is strictly concave and goes to minus infinity as the norm of x goes to plus infinity. So this follows from the computation phi of ys at x. Okay, so you can break here 1 plus s divided by s norm of xy square, okay, as the sum of x minus y square and 1 over s x minus y square. Okay, so once you have done that, you just now develop x minus y square, and you get that it is distance square of x to c minus x square plus the linear map to scalar product of y x minus y square, which is a constant, minus 1 over x minus y square norm, x minus 1 norm squared. Now the first function here, the first part here, is concave. Okay, why? Because you already know that d square, the distance from x to c squared minus the norm of x squared is concave, and you are adding to it, sorry, it's a minus here. It should be, no, it's a plus, so it should be a plus here. Okay, so this function here is concave because the sum of the first two terms is concave, as we saw, and the second one is affine. Y is fixed here, okay? So this function is concave. And the claim follows from this that phi ys is the sum of a concave function. And as any concave function, it's bounded above by a linear map. And the function x maps to x minus y squared divided by s, which is strictly concave, okay? And converges quadratically to minus infinity as x goes to plus infinity. The first one converges at most linearly to plus infinity as x goes to plus infinity. And the second one decreases to minus infinity, okay, quadratically. So in the end, that tells you that f of y is x goes to minus infinity as norm of x goes to plus infinity. And it's the sum of a concave function and a strictly concave function. So it is strictly concave. So this function here, phi of ys, is strictly concave, okay? So, and goes to minus infinity as x goes to plus infinity. So it must achieve a minimum, and by the strict convexity, it must achieve a maximum because it goes to minus infinity when x goes to plus infinity. And so it must achieve a maximum, and this maximum must be unique by the strict convexity. Okay. Now the concavity of phi of yx implies that f of ys is also the unique local maximum of phi of ys. Remember, in a concave function, local maximum are also global maximum. And they are the point, in case you have a differentiability, they are the points at which the derivative is zero. And because of that, because it's a unique local maximum, you can show as an exercise that f is a continuous function of ys for y in Rk and s is positive. So this is kind of standard exercise. So f is continuous automatically by uniqueness and enough concavity. So also note that the value of phi of ys at y is just the square of the distance of y to c, okay? So if you evaluate phi of ys at f of ys, it should be larger than its distance squared of y to c. And by reshuffling, you end up, okay, you replace here x by f of ys, and then just, and here x and x by f of yx. And this has to be larger than d square of the distance of square of y to c. And then you put the term here with a minus sign to the right. So you get that the distance square to c of y, f of ys, is larger than 1 plus s divided by s, the norm of f of ys minus y squared, plus the distance of y to c squared. Okay. A first consequence, it tells you that the distance of f of ys squared is larger than the distance of y to c squared. And using that the distance of c to f of ys is less than the distance of c to y or y to c, plus the distance between the point f of yx and y, because dc has Lipschitz constant less than one, equal one. Okay, so we get using this. Okay, so I replace here. I take an upper bound of the distance of f of ys in the inequality above. And therefore, I get that the distance of y to c plus the norm of f of ys minus y squared is larger than 1 plus s, the norm of f of ys minus y squared plus the distance of y to c squared. And if I expand the square and do the cancellation, I end up with twice the distance of f of ys, twice the distance of f of ys to y times the distance of y to c is larger than 1 over s, the distance of f of ys to y squared. And of course, this implies that simplifying by the square here and the norm on to the left, So we end up with norm of f of y s minus y is less than 2s distance from y to c. The inequality just obtained, okay, together with the continuity of f. So you have continuity of f and this inequality here, okay, and this is continuous. Okay, and when s go to zero, that tells me that I can extend f by the identity for s equals zero. Okay, it also tells me that when y is in c, this is this distance of y to c is zero, and therefore I remain forever at c. And also the first one tells me that I increase the distance to C along f of ys. Or I don't decrease the distance more precisely. And of course, this implies that if I start away from C, I stay away from C. Now it remains to prove the fourth property. Namely, if the distance to C square is differentiable at f of ys, then y is in the unique segment between the unique projection C of f of ys, C f ys of f of ys on C and f of ys, so it is on the segment between these two points. And the function is differentiable, d square c is differentiable at y, and the distance from f of ys to c is 1 plus s times the distance of y to c. Now, of course, this implies that if I start at the singularity, I remain always in the singularities. Now also, so I don't have to prove the last part, it's obvious from the third. And moreover, because f of y zero is y, pi part four is clear for s equals zero. It's tautological. So I can assume that s is positive. So if s is positive, f of y s is the unique point x at which phi of y s reaches the maximum. Okay, so because x minus y square as a function of x is c infinite, if d square, if the distance to c squared is differentiable at f of ys, so is phi ys, and because phi ys reaches the maximum at f of ys, the gradient at f of ys of the gradient of f of ys okay, must be, so the gradient of f of ys at f ys must be zero because it's a maximum. So if you compute the gradient, so you have the gradient of d square, of the distance square, distance to c squared at f of ys, and if you compute here the derivative is minus 2, 1 plus s divided by s, the scalar product, so it's a scalar product, not parenthesis. No, sorry. The gradient of the norm of x minus y squared at x equals f of yx is exactly 2 times f of ys minus y. Okay, so we get this equation, but we already computed that the gradient of the distance to C square at a point where it is differentiable. So here f of ys is twice the point, so f of ys minus the projection of the point on C, so C of f of ys, okay? And therefore, combining these two equalities here, we obtain that f of ys minus C of fys minus 1 plus s divided by s times the vector f minus fys minus y is 0, which is equivalent to y is equal to 1 over s f of ys plus s divided by 1 plus s c of fys. Okay? So if I look at this equality with s positive, together with the fact that the sum of the two coefficients is 1 and the coefficients are positive, of course, it tells me that y is between the two points f of ys and c f of ys on the segment between the two points, strictly on the segment, and therefore it is differentiable there. So, because it's on the segment between C of f of ys and f of ys, that tells me that distance to C squared is differentiable at y, and the projection of y on C is also C f of ys. Now I'm going to compute the distance of y to C, so because the projection of y is C of CFYS, it's the norm of y minus CFYS. So I replace y by its expression as a linear combination. Okay. And I carry out the simplification here. And I end up that it is the norm of 1 over S F of YS minus 1 over S C of F of YS. So if I factor y out over 1 plus S, I get norm of f of ys minus c of f of ys, which is exactly the distance from f of ys to c. And this gives me the equation I wanted. The distance of f of ys to c is 1 plus s, the distance from y to c. So this finished to prove that lemma, the properties of f. Okay. Now, to prove that the inclusion is a homotopy equivalent, I need a lemma on further properties of F. The homotopy now that I found maps, in fact, the complement, it's a homotopy of the complement of the Aubry set into itself. And the second property is that for every compact subset of the complement of the Aubry set, you can find a time sk for the homotopy such that f of ys belongs to the singularity of the distance of to c squared for all y in k and s larger than sk. So this homotopy on every compact subset of the complement of the Aubry set, you can find a time such that after that time, it maps the compact subset always to the singularities. So we recall that d square c is differentiable at every point of the Aubry set of c. And to prove A, we are going to argue by contradiction. Suppose that Y is not in the Aubry set, and for some S, we have F of YS is in the Aubry set. So this implies that F of YS has a unique projection because it's differentiable D square C dc square is differentiable at f of ys, which is in the Aubry set. So it implies that the projection of f of y s is on the is unique, and also that the segment between f of y s, c of f of y s and f of y s is in the Aubry set. In fact, the whole half line containing that segment and starting at c of f y s toward f of y s is in the Aubry set by definition of the Aubry set. Okay. So again, the differentiability implies of the differentiability of the distance to c squared at f of y s implies by part four of the previous lemma that y itself is in the segment between c of f y s and f of y s, okay, but that segment is in the Aubry set, and that contradicts the fact that y is not in the Aubry set, okay? So we have proved that if you start away from the Aubry set, you remain always away from the Aubry set. Now, to prove part B, which is that for every compact set, I can find a uniform time such that f always send points into singularities for time higher than that time. I also argue by contradiction. So if B is false, for each n larger than one, I can find a yn in k such that, and the time sn with sn going to plus infinity such that f of yn sn is not in the singularities of dc squared. Okay, I can find arbitrary high time, so I can find like that, so I can find the sequence sn going to infinity like that. Okay, now if I do that again by part fourth of the previous lemma, I have that f of yn sn has a unique projection on C, which I'm going to call as usual C of f of y n s n. Okay. I also have, because I am differentiable at d square C is differentiable at f of y n s n, is that y n is also in the segment between C of f n, C f of y n s n to f of y n s n, and also something on the distance of f of yn sn to c, it's 1 plus sn, the distance of c to yn. Okay, so this I can interpret it as saying that the length of the segment from c f of ysn to f of ysn is 1 plus sn, distance from yn to c. And moreover, because I'm differentiable at that point, the distance from Z to C is Z minus C F of YNSN, the norm of C minus C of YNSN for every Z in that segment. Okay? So if I am differentiable at some point, I am differentiable along every segment. Every point, I am differential at every point along the segment between the projection and the point f of yn sn. And I realize the distance like that. So this is part four of the lemma. Okay. Now, because K is compact and disjoint from AC, which contains C, the infimum of the distance of C, the infimum of the distance of C for y in K is positive, and the supremum of the distance to C for a point in K is also finite. Okay. And therefore, I can apply this to Yn. Okay, what is the distance from Yn to C? It's Yn minus C of FnSn as we. Okay. Because we know that the projection of Yn onto C is also C of F of YnSn. So we have the inequality, okay, here. So this inequality, because Yn is in K, and the distance from Yn to C of Fn YnSn is bounded, tells me that the sequence C of YnSn is also bounded in Rn, okay? And the first one, Yn, is bounded because it's in a compact set. And the second one is bounded because it's bounded distance from the bounded sequence Yn. And extracting, if necessary, I can assume that Yn converges to Y, which is going to be in K, of course, because K is compact. And C of FynSn is going to converge to C in C. Here there is a small c, the point C, here in C, it's missing here. So I can take the limit of this inequality, and I get that y minus c is away from zero, okay? So that tells me, this inequality tells me that c of yn, c of fynSn is different from Yn, and Y is different from C. And therefore, the half line starting at C of F of YnSn and containing Yn converges to the half line L plus starting at C and containing Y. Okay, so here is the picture. Okay, so I have these segments, and I know the Ym converges to Y. Okay, the Yn converges to Y, and the C, F of YnSn, converges to C. Now, I know, as I said, that the length of this segment, which contains Yn, is larger than 1 plus Sn distance of Yn to C, but the distance of Yn to C is larger than the infimum of the distance of C on K, okay? But the infimum of this distance is a constant, which is positive, Sn go to plus infinity. So the length of the segment, okay, C F YnSn to F of YnSn tends to plus infinity, okay? This implies that every point Z in the limit half line, okay, is a limit of sequence of point Zn in the segment C F of YnSn to F of YnSn. Okay, so this is a picture. So any point Z is limit of points on the segments. But I know that the distance from Zn to C is Zn minus C of F of YnSn, that's one of the things that we showed above. And so if I let this go to infinity, as n go to infinity, I obtain that the distance of Z to C is norm of Z minus C for every Z in L plus. Okay. Thus, this implies that the half line is contained in the Aubry set. This is a contradiction, since Y is in the limit of the segment, so it's in the half line, which is in the Aubry set, but Y is in K, which is disjoint from the Aubry set. So finally, we proved part two, part B, by contradiction of the part B of the lemma by contradiction. Let me remind you what part B is. If you take a compact set which is joined from the Aubry set, then you can find a uniform time such that F maps the whole of K to the singularities for every time larger than this uniform time. So let me come to the proof of the global homotopy theorem now. So I know already that F maps, so there is an F missing here. F maps, it's a homotopy of the complement of the Aubry set. Okay. Now I'm going to construct a continuous function alpha defined on the complement of the Aubry set and with non-negative values such that f of y, alpha of y, is in the singularities of the distance to c squared for all y in the complement of the Aubry set. So for this, we choose an open cover of the complement of the Aubry set by open sets such that the closure of every open set OI is compact and contained in the complement of the Aubry set. So by part B of the previous lemma, for each I, I can find the time SI such that F of YS is in the singularity of the distance to C squared for all OI in O of Y bar and all times S larger than SI. Now I choose the locally finite partition of unity subordinated to the open cover UI, I call it phi I. And I defined alpha by alpha I is the sum of the SI phi I of Y. Alpha I of Y is the sum for Y in I of S of phi Y I. Now we have to show that F of alpha, or F of Y, alpha Y, is indeed in the singularity of DC squared for all Y in the complement of the Aubry set. So fix such a Y in the complement of the Aubry set. And because the partition of unity is locally finite, I can, the set I of Y, which is a set of I in Y, such that phi I of Y is positive, is finite, okay? Therefore, Y is in O of Y for Y in I of Y, and alpha Y is just the sum of the, sorry, SI, there is an SI missing here. It's just the sum of for I in I of Y of SI phi Y of I. Okay, the other terms are zero. So because I of I is finite, I can find an I zero such that S of I zero is the minimum for I in I of Y of the SI. And this implies that alpha Y is larger than S of Y zero. And by definition of now, because I know that Y is in O of Y zero, okay, because I zero is in I of Y, and by the defining property of S of Y zero, this implies that F of Y, alpha Y, is indeed in the singularity of DC squared as required. So we now define the homotopy G on the complement of the Aubry set, time 0, 1 by G of YS is f of y s of alpha y. Okay. Now, of course, I have g start at the identity, and at time one, g of y1 is f of y1 alpha. There is no s here, so it's in the singularity. We can therefore consider the map G sub 1, which is G at time 1, as a map from RK minus alpha C into the set of the singularity of the square of DC. In fact, this map is an inverse, is a homotopy inverse of the inclusion of the singularity of DC square into the complement of the Aubry set. Why? In fact, if I look at I, G1, and G is a homotopy with value in R. So I, G1 is G1 as a set map, takes that, they take the same value, and G is a homotopy with value in R, in the complement of the Aubry set, between the identity of the complement of the Aubry set and I, G1. So we have shown that I, G1 is homotopic to the identity. We have to show that G1I, which is also G1 on singularity of DC square, is itself is homotopic as a map to the identity of the singularity of DC square. And this is indeed the case, since for Y in in the singularity, we know that the homotopy all along, okay, stays in the singularities. G stays all along in the singularity by part four of the lemma. Remember, the homotopy has the property that if you start from a singularity, you always stay in a singularity. So this implies that G restricted to the set of the singularity of DC squared is a required homotopy, which shows that G1 composed with I is homotopic to the identity of the singularity of DC squared as maps from the singularity of DC squared to itself. And I'm going to stop here, and I'll put on the slides a sketch of the local homotopy theorem. So that's it.
Thank you, Albert. And clap for everybody.
Okay.
So thank you, Albert, for this very nice series of lectures. Hopefully next time they will be in Rome. I mean, in the near future, we wait for you in Rome.
Hopefully. Hopefully. Yeah. Just be careful.
Why?
Well, people should be careful, and then we will be able to travel.
Yeah.
But if people start to do crazy things, like decide to go where they shouldn't go first, it will be a problem.
Yeah, it's a delicate time.
It has started again in Israel.
And soccer is not helping.